آج تک خدا نے اس قوم کی حالت نہیں بدلی نہ ہو جس کو خیال خود اپنی حالت بدلنے کا. This was the message from my Dr. Elias, and he highlighted a some of the basic issue that gave the significance of education and advised the young generation not to blame, not to lament for any discrimination and try to create a confidence and competency. This was a message. I am very thankful. Now I invite another speaker of the today's function, Professor V.K. Srivastava. He is a basically anthropologist from Delhi.
Well, I have not prepared my speech. In fact, I didn't know that I'll have to speak here. I am very pleased with two things. Number one, that this has been one of the most orderly, organized seminar. Things have went off very well. Although I could not attend many of the sessions, but I learned a great deal from those who participated that the seminar was a huge success. And I would request Professor Mateen to collect these papers and put them in a volume. This will be a lasting contribution to the studies pertaining to social exclusion and inclusive policy. This is number one. You know, already we have been told more than 100 papers have been presented. The second is, what I find is that here in the seminar, an attempt has been made to make use of social exclusion as a perspective. It is very clearly known now that social exclusion is a way of approaching the problems of communities. It is a methodology for looking at deprivation, segregation, the processes of alienation and marginalization. And the concept is truly coming to age. The concept which is not very old. I think, if I'm not wrong, it was in 1974 that a French author, René Lenoir, used the word social exclusion. And it was used, you know, when it was used for the first time, it was used not only for the groups, but also for individuals. And it was almost a concept in which everything was put. I mean, those which are called umbrella concepts, canopy concepts, everything put in this. And gradually, over a period of time, it has emerged into a methodology. It has emerged into a philosophy. It has emerged into a perspective of looking at all kinds of communities, looking at all types of marginalization. And from that point of view, this seminar has made tremendous contribution to the conceptual understanding, asking questions like, this is what I surmised from the report which Dr. Mohammed presented, that the questions like what constitutes the mainstream of society? Who is excluded? What are the processes of exclusion? What is the meaning of the term exclusion? Why one thing becomes alienated? Why one thing is separated? And then the idea of inclusion. What is to be included? With whom is to be included? How exclusion presents itself? What are the symbols? What are the institutions, you know, which are putting it forth? I believe that the task of the universities, research centers, is first to understand this, that why it is so, to provide an objective, dispassionate, crystal clear understanding of the entire thing, why this happened. Now, for this, what is required is, and I'm sure Professor Abdul Mateen in his speech will talk about this, what is required is empirical studies. There are two aspects. One is that you say something on the basis of your impressions. We are always, I am a sociologist and a social anthropologist, and I believe that all of us are always field working. We are always collecting information. We are looking at the things and we are trying to understand their significance. We are trying to understand the relevance. And when we are understanding the other community, we are also understanding our own community. So it is in this process of dialectical process of understanding the other and understanding the self that knowledge is created. So one is some kind of impressionistic understanding, and the other is carefully, meticulously carried out studies. Insofar as I know that there has been a decline in the studies of Muslim communities, empirical studies of Muslim communities all over the country. I know about the sociology and anthropology departments where there are hardly any people who are spending time with Muslim communities, who are trying to understand, who are trying to prepare their ethnographies and providing objective information about them. There has been a decline, and why it is happening is one of the reasons is that most of us go back to our own communities for study. Suppose I happen to come from Assam, I'll go back to Assam, study my own people. So this whole thing of exploring the other communities, trying to find out, trying to understand the so-called marginalized community, this has been a decline. I think centers like this can make a phenomenal contribution to this, to provide this kind of a material. Take up the empirical study and let us know what exactly is happening. You know, this is absolutely fine, and I have firm faith in the methodology of participatory approach. Professor Elias said it very clearly that the communities have to help themselves. After all, in the theory of participation, we say that the last kind of participation is what is called self-mobilization. And self-mobilization is superior to what they say, interactive mobilization, which means that the community decides. Self-mobilization is the community decides what it wants, the community decides how one should approach is, and the community knows how to go about it. The community is not dependent upon anyone to come and tell them what they have to do. This is what we have to achieve. And I firmly believe in this participatory model. Nevertheless, we have to understand things like why this marginalization is occurring, which historical factors are responsible for this, and why it creates a situation where some are able to make use of the structures of opportunities which are available, and some are not able to make use of those opportunities. I am instantly reminded of this very famous article by Amartya Sen, which is on the concept of social exclusion, and where Professor Sen says that you can go back to the writings of Adam Smith for these, and where he quotes that there are some who can't appear before public or who can't appear in public without shame. So there are some who are always ashamed when they appear in public, and there are others who are not like this. How these kinds of differences are created, where some remain without opportunities and where the others are able to make use of these opportunities. How these structures are generated, because once we know the dialectics, once we know the processes which give rise to these structures, we will be able to provide some kind of a solution. We'll be able to suggest how should one go about it. And so I have firm faith in these centers and in this approach. You see, social exclusion is certainly not a new concept, but it is a new way of looking at the processes of marginalization, processes of deprivation, and the processes of generation of poverty, and poverty being carried over a period of time. So I personally believe that these centers would be able to give a lot of insight, number one, to the process of marginalization, and will be able to refine the methodological tools. Now the last thing, you see, I love Urdu, and I just because of the fact of birth. I was born in a caste family and from UP, and the first thing which I learned as a child was that Urdu is your mother tongue and you have to learn it. I learned Urdu as a child, and I later on developed interest in Urdu poetry. And as you know, as all teenagers, you try to memorize as much Urdu poetry as possible, sometimes diwans after diwans, which I also did as a teenager, later on as an adolescent. And I have been reading Urdu literature, particularly poetry, because that has been my interest. And I think this university can really, you know, make a tremendous contribution to the generation of material in Urdu language. You know, when it comes to, say, for example, sociology, you hardly have any books. I was asking Professor Mateen that you have an MPhil program whereby you teach students in Urdu. Where is the material available? And my suggestion was that the best way to generate the material is, this is my suggestion is, that you ask me to give a lecture in Urdu. Urdu, Hindi, you know, some kind of a mix. Tape that lecture, okay? It should be transcribed. And then I should edit it. And if there are words for which equivalents can be found, or certain words can be devised, okay, they can be done. And finally, you will have some kind of a manuscript, which can further be revisited, which can be edited, and we will be able to generate material. It is not only, this is, I think, and it will be a great service to the language and also to the lovers of Urdu, very, very beautiful language, as all of you know, is generation of this material. And it would be really excellent that if we are able to provide some kind of material in Urdu, you know, for the understanding of these kinds of problems. So I see a lot of hope and a lot of future in this center, not only from the point of view of understanding the processes of marginalization, but also communicating that knowledge in Urdu. Thanks a lot.
Now, before inviting today's main speaker, I will say a few words about his academic achievement. He is a product of Andhra University. He did his master from Andhra University in economics. Then he did his PhD from Andhra University. Then he joined a faculty of economics in Andhra University. Then he came to Hyderabad University as an associate professor. Then he left to Bombay as a professor of economics, where during his tenure he was the honorary director of Western Region Center ICSSR Bombay. Again, he came back to as a professor at University of Hyderabad. After that, the government has recognized the academic achievement, and he has become the vice chancellor of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar University, Lucknow. From there, he retired, again came back to Hyderabad University. Now he is the dean of social science, Hyderabad University. He is a very widely traveled man. He has a large number of books to his credit, and he is a specialist in international economics, Ambedkar economics, and agriculture economics. And now I invite you to deliver the valedictory address.
At the outset, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks for having invited me to deliver this address on this occasion, particularly to the Director Martin of this center. Friends, I was one of those who has been associated from the beginning with these centers, from the inception of these centers at University Grants Commission level. So the idea was that this particular aspect, like social exclusion and inclusive policy, has not been a part of mainstream academics in universities. And given the importance of this subject, there is a need for promoting these studies in higher education institutions like universities and colleges. So that is how University Grants Commission has started. Initially, about 19 these centers, and afterwards its number rise to about 34 or 35. Friends, I am glad to know most of these centers have been working very effectively. And having heard the summary of the last 3 days, the seminar, I mean, deliberations, I could understand that very wide variety, wide range of topics have been covered in this seminar, and which are very important, not only for the development of these marginalized and minority sections, also for the nation itself. Friends, I would like to make, a few remarks in the forum of this address, particularly with a special reference to the Dalits, where I did some work, and also a few remarks with reference to these minorities. Friends, to understand this exclusion problem of this excluded community, particularly Dalits, one has to go into its historical background. And as you know, this caste-based social order, which is, as far as my understanding goes, which is mainly responsible for the exclusion of these groups, which is very significant in numbers, in terms of their proportion out of the total population. Of course, this is my understanding, that this caste-based social order is mainly responsible for the exclusion of these groups. Friends, in this particular social system, as you know, not only the people are divided into watertight compartments, but it is a closed and a rigid system. And at the same time, the privileges would rise in an ascending order, and at the same time, the privileges go down in the descending order. The lower sections, the lower strata, particularly these ex-untouchables, were denied all kinds of opportunities for their development, either social, economic, or political development. This kind of a system, of course, not only just excluded these groups, but at the same time caused a lot of damage from the point of view of national growth and national integrity. Because, see, in this system, what has happened, when the occupations were assigned on the basis of the birth, the individual's inclinations or individual aptitudes did not find any place. The status of a person was also determined on the basis of the birth in a particular caste. Nothing to do with these achievements. At the same time, all avenues are closed for a particular individual, and no one can cross his limits. He should confine to the occupation which is assigned. And this kind of a rigid and closed system has been legitimized in the name of the God by propagating that it has been a divine creation. And as you know, this caste system's important byproduct was the untouchability. And by untouchability simply does not mean, in the words of Ambedkar, only a kind of a social or a religious system, but it has also a lot of economic implications. Because the ex-untouchables have to perform a number of duties without expecting sometimes any remuneration. They didn't have any kind of any bargaining power. And moreover, they were assigned all kinds of flinty jobs where there is no adequate remuneration for their livelihood. So that is how this group was excluded from the mainstream of social and economic life. And at the same time, this system, based on this caste, caused a kind of a name, I mean, was responsible for this kind of an exclusiveness and also the low levels of living. And today, still today, they suffer from high incidence of poverty. Therefore, friends, what I try to say is, when you try to understand this exclusiveness, particularly with reference to certain social groups like Dalits, one has to look into the historical background and what kind of social system that was prevalent either before the independence or even after the independence, what is its influence even today, this caste-based social order one should understand. I will come back to the minorities later. Let me spend a few more minutes on the problems of the Dalits. Friends, of course, one may say that in the post-independence period, particularly when the Indian Constitution has been adopted, we have practically abolished on paper these kind of taboos or these kind of disabilities with which or from which these communities have suffered for centuries. Yes, it is true that Indian Constitution has not only abolished these things like untouchability and also made some kind of positive provisions in the name of positive discrimination for the protection of these people. It is true. But even after 60 years of this Indian Republic, if you look at the present scenario, see, India as a whole, yes, there is a significant economic growth, and at the same time, it is also established very recently, particularly in the post-liberalization, there is also widening of economic inequalities. Number two, if you look at the these communities, especially these Dalits, when I use the word Dalits, of course, I am also including the scheduled tribes, which is also in a segregated community, which is also outside the caste system. Therefore, I am including this community also, tribes also under these Dalits. If you look at these sections, even today, nearly 50% of these people suffer from utter poverty without 2 square meals per day. The reason is because they started without any kind of an economic background. They were denied opportunities to improve their economic life. They were denied education. Therefore, naturally, they didn't have any access to the gainful employment from the beginning. So whatever that employment was there, which did not provide them adequate incomes, they remain to be essentially depending as on date. If you look at the statistics either supplied by National Sample Survey data or census data, more than 50% of Dalits remain to be the agricultural laborers as landless laborers. And about 75 to 80% of them depend on agriculture for their livelihood, including the marginal farmers of these communities. So they essentially depend on agriculture, and 80% of these Dalits live in rural India even today, although it is just around 68% in case of non-SCST groups who are living in rural India. So their degree of urbanization is also very less compared to the general population because they didn't have the necessary skills. And if you look at their access to land, which is an important source of improving economic status or generating income in the rural India, if you look at their position with reference to access to land, about 22% of rural households belong to scheduled caste households, but their control over the land under cultivation in the rural India is not more than 9%. That is how their access to land is very meager. As a matter of fact, in between 1991 and 2001 census, in 1991 it was found that they were controlling about 10%. By 2001, it has come down to around 9%. Strictly speaking, their access has come down in the post-liberalization period to the land. This is one important aspect. Second one, at the same time, despite land reform, you see, other kind of developmental measures, you know, the inequality in the agrarian structure continues. Equity could not be established. Although, as far as that objective of removing intermediaries from Indian agriculture could be achieved, like Jamindars and Jagirdars could be removed, but land has passed the hands. But even today, land concentration continues. The top 25% of farming community controls about 75% of land. This is one of the reasons why you could see higher incidence of poverty in rural India, even in the prosperous states like Haryana and Punjab or some parts of Andhra Pradesh, where there was a green revolution, tremendous progress in agricultural production, but high incidence of poverty can be seen, particularly in certain social groups, which happen to be the agricultural laborers like Dalits or tribes. In case of tribes, as a matter of fact, incidence of poverty is higher. So this is the present situation. And as far as their educational achievements are concerned, in the post-independence period, of course, compared to the pre-independence period, obviously there is some improvement. Their literacy rates have gone up from zero literacy rates roughly 100 years ago, more than 100 years ago. Now, about more than 50% of these communities became literates who can read and write because of the various measures undertaken. But general literacy rate is about 65, which is very small compared to the neighboring nations, even in the case of general population. Friends, what I try to say is, another important dimension is that since they continue to remain in the rural India, and particularly as agricultural laborers, although some degree of mobility is there, because they did not have the required skills to enter into the non-farming community. This is one important reason. Other important reason is, of course, to what extent non-farming employment opportunities are thrown open, that is a different issue. Of course, that limitation is also there. Even given some opportunities, they could not make use of it because they lack the skills for want of required higher education or whatever it may be. Because their enrollment in the higher education is not more than 4%, 6% in case of scheduled caste, and not more than 4% in case of scheduled tribe. So essentially, they remain to be in agriculture. Other important dimension is, because they are living as a landless agricultural laborers, mostly in rural India, there were also social tensions. And in the process of these social tensions, on account of two or three important reasons, when these people try to insist on minimum wages, and when they try to take the position of the assigned lands or redistributed lands by the government, there was a tension, there was a conflict between the land-owning communities and these sections, and as a result, there is a lot of social tensions. And these social tensions even today are of higher order in those states which are retaining the feudal character even now, like Bihar and some other states, and also in other states because of the pauperization of these groups. Friends, what I try to say is, as far as these groups are concerned, although some effort has been made in improving their living conditions, particularly through educational measures and other measures, but still they are lagging far behind the general population, and there is a lot need to be done for them. But here I see there is a very important role to be played by the state. Particularly in the context of this liberalization, it is true, as our distinguished colleague was mentioning, that a lot of opportunities were thrown. But at the same time, to make use of these opportunities, you require certain skills. Because today, the generated employment is not like just a labor-intensive employment. In the context of liberalization, it is either highly knowledge-intensive, or capital-intensive employment for which people require the skills. When these people do not have any access to higher education, now today in the context of globalization, naturally higher education become more expensive, and most of these groups are not having any kind of an access. Under these circumstances, you cannot expect that these groups can definitely make use of the opportunities thrown in the context of the liberalization. It is already established that the inequalities have been further widened in the context of the liberalization, and at the same time, the adjustment costs of this liberalization are mostly borne by these vulnerable groups, and losing their access to some of the important instruments of development like education and other things. Other point, you see, when you take up the therefore, what I try to say here is that in the case of these underprivileged sections, there is a need for further implementation of this agrarian reform, number one, and also state has to play a very crucial role, at least in the social sector, although you can't be completely away from the process of the globalization, which is an international phenomena as on date, whole because developmental process is more oriented towards, market oriented today rather than the state oriented. So in this process, obviously, you can't completely be away from this kind of a process, but at the same time, there is every possibility for the state to play a very important role, at least in the social sector. Because the neighboring nations example is that if you take either the South Korea or Taiwan, some other neighboring nations, including China, where the state has played a very important role in making their structures more egalitarian, and at the same time, in implementing the land reform and the educational reform. Through educational reform, people became skilled, more skilled, and their productivity levels have gone up like anything. This kind of a reform, what I call now internal reform, as far as India is concerned, still there is a need for that. And without doing that, even if there is any some kind of a growth on account of this liberalization, these marginalized sections may not be in a position to make use of that, except a few who are having the necessary skills and the necessary educational attainments. Friends, let me also mention a few words about other important section of the Indian society, that is minorities. As on date, around 18.5%, as per the 2001 census, about 18.1% of the population belongs to these religious minorities. As you know, these five religious minority communities were grouped under a category of minorities: Muslims, Christians, Buddhists, Sikhs, and Parsis. But they constitute about 18.5% of the total population, which is a very significant percentage. Of which, as you know, Muslims' share is largest. They constitute about 13.5% of the total population. That is nearly 14 crores of this country as per the 2001 census belong to these Muslims. Now, previously, as you know, because census were providing the lot of information on the sections like Dalits or the tribes, something like that, we could study and we could understand. But we did not have the required information on the communities like the backward classes also previously. Very recently, the NSS has started collecting some data on backward classes. Similarly, on the minorities, except knowing their percentages of the populations in the total population. But interestingly, with the help of that Sachar committee, we could understand the socio-economic status also of the minorities, particularly Muslims, which constitute about 75% of the total minorities and about 13.5% of the total population of the country. We could understand where do they stand vis-a-vis the rest of the society. See, of course, one or two things I can repeat from the Sachar committee. Sachar committee has pointed out that even today, out of every 25 graduate students, only one belongs to Muslims. At the PG level, out of every 50, one belongs to Muslim community. And the stunting children rate is highest among the Muslim community, and it has the second highest rate as far as undernutrition children are concerned. Similarly, there are other indicators, which show that their socio-economic development is far behind the other general population. For example, their literacy rate is, of course, about 58%, but generally literacy rate is about 65% or something like that. But when you look at their occupations, interestingly, as on date, from the Sachar committee only, which was a part, summary was reproduced in 11th plan document from which I am speaking, taking this information. You could see that as far as occupational distribution is concerned, only 20% of the workers of the Muslims are cultivators, but their work participation rate is very less, only around 30%, which is about 40%, 39% in general population, which is slightly more than 40% in case of SCs and STs. Work participation rate is less. 20% are cultivators, but most, and 20% are only agricultural laborers, but the rest All the 60% remain in the various occupations. What are their main occupations as on date? Since they are also not land owners as on date, as they don't have the required land, naturally they have to depend upon other occupations, and their educational levels are also found to be very low. Therefore, they were depending upon the occupations which are like a kind of a petty trade, shopkeepers, carpenters, other kind, mostly these kind of artisan occupations they are concentrated. Why I am specifically mentioning this point is it has some importance in the context of liberalization. If you look at the developments in the post-liberalization period, although economic growth has registered higher growth rates in the country, like in our country, but the point is, as I was mentioning, inequalities have widened, but these benefits, obviously growth benefits, even before the liberalization, growth benefits did not percolate down. And even after the liberalization, the growth benefits are mostly cornered by the top strata, which are having the socio-economic base, which are having the much access to the economic income-generating economic assets. But these groups did not have that kind of an access. Ultimately, they have to settle in those occupations because they didn't have the required skills, required education to enter into that higher occupations. Therefore, they have to settle in these kind of artisan occupations where income level is very low. Obviously, naturally, these groups have to suffer from significant higher incidences of poverty. So friends, what I try to say is here, with reference to this, of course, as far as other minority groups are concerned, Sikhs, for example, the other development indicator, as far as developmental indicators are concerned, in the case of Sikhs, it is far better, and more than 40% of Sikhs are cultivators, and similarly, educational development indicators in the case of other minority like Christians and even Parsis, and these groups are having a far better indicators, even sometimes compared to the general groups, other general population. That is why clubbing all the minorities, religious minorities, in a single bracket has also its own problems to understand the problems of the minorities. This particular group, which is the largest, there is a need for studying separately because of the present their given socio-economic developmental level, which is far below. What I try to say is, given their socio-economic development, which is found to be maybe slightly better than these deprived sections like Dalits, but far below the general population, therefore, the state, what I feel is that there is a need for state to play a very important role. Of course, constitution guarantees preserving their culture, preserving their religion, propagating their religion, whatever it may be, starting their own educational institutions, something like that. These are very much given. But in addition to that, what I said is, in order to improve their access to education so that they can enter into the better of occupations, and they can, so that they can come to the mainstream of economic life, the state has to play a very important role here. I am not going to give you the details what kind of measures state has to take, but the state, with reference to these groups also, there is a need for playing an important role by taking some kind of special measures so that their skills are improved, and at the same time, their educational levels are improved. And the particularly with reference to Muslim women, the indicators are very weak. I mean to say, socio-economic development, educational indicators are very weak. With reference to that group particularly, state has to play an important role. Although one may think that we should not look towards the state or somebody else, we should depend on our own. Yes, this proportion is definitely appreciated, but at the same time, in a democratic country, to make the country, not only the people, to make the country itself strong, the state has a certain roles to function. For example, when the Indian community adopted this parliamentary democracy as a method of governance, it does not mean that it is only political democracy. State was assigned a very important role in bringing socio-economic democracy consistent with political democracy. Then only this political democracy can be sustained. Otherwise, there will be always a threat to this political democracy unless socio-economic democracies simultaneously achieved. In this process, friends, what I try to say is that there is a need for state to play a very important role. This is the lesson, of course, this you can see even from some other, even Western countries like England also, which was a welfare state. Many states have played a very important role, including South Korea, in fostering their economic development with justice. Friends, therefore, I once again say that with reference to these minority groups, particularly Muslims, state has to play a very special role so that their socio-economic developmental status is improved. With these few words, I thank you all, and I once again thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity.